Okay, I'm ready.
Let me tell a couple of words before you start.
Yeah.
Roland, before you do that, should we ask participants to switch their microphones off, please?
Yes.
Please, everybody switch off the microphone. Just when you're asking questions, you can switch it on. Not to interrupt the talk. Thank you. And now, it's our pleasure to announce the speaker today. It's Professor Grubb from Copenhagen University. She's emeritus professor there, very famous and very well-known mathematician. She was, I think, I don't know it exactly, but I think she was disciple of Lars Hermander. And at least she has done a lot of work together with Lars Hermander. And it's our pleasure to hear her today. And she will tell us about boundary problems for fractional order operators. Please.
Okay, yeah, thank you very much for inviting me. And I know I have been invited actually quite many times to come to Georgia and I never went because it was too complicated. But this is a wonderful way to come, at least.
Yes.
In a virtual manner. Okay, so I will speak about these fractional order operators. So I have a little plan. I will do more, I'll tell more about the history of how this work came about than I usually do. But then I will go to the recent results on regularity of solutions of boundary value problems. And then I'll mention a few other aspects, namely the immediate problem is the homogeneous problem, but what you can also define non-homogeneous problems. And you can do integration by parts formulas, and you can do heat equations, evolution equations. And then at the end, I will say something about non-smooth situations, because that's very recent that we've managed to get some results there. And I also made a list of people who have contributed, and it's just a list of names to you. But anyway, you know, it's here on one of the slides. I won't mention so many names as I go along. Okay, so just to fix ideas, I recall that a pseudo differential operator is defined as an operator P, big P, defined from a symbol small p of x and xi, n-dimensional variables, and it's defined by use of the Fourier transform. You plug in the Fourier transform of U, you multiply by Px Xi, and then you Fourier transform back with respect to Xi. So this X is a parameter that equals the parameter you get when you Fourier transform back. And I have to, now that I'm in touch with you guys, I must say that it has given lots of trouble that you have a plus here, and in the Western literature, we have a minus. So it's very difficult to, or it can be difficult to compare formulas. But anyway, if one really wants to, it's of course possible. So what about the symbols? Well, first of all, boundary problems is a known aspect of this type of operators. And the symbols, I'll just take them classical. And what does that mean? P is classical of order m, means that the function p, little p, the symbol has an asymptotic expansion in homogeneous symbols. So the symbols are numbered by j and they fall off by degree by one step each time j augments one step. And they are only assumed, I had to make this assumption only outside a ball around zero to have smooth symbols. And what does the asymptotic mean? Well, it means that when you take the terms up to or down to j equals some capital J and subtract from p, then the remainder is of a better order, one step better order. And I will always, or most of the talk, I will consider omega as a smooth open subset of Rn. Okay, the case that's closest to differential operators, that is when m is integer, because differential operators are, of course, integer order. And the symbol satisfies this condition here, the zero transmission condition at the boundary. It means you take a point at the boundary, you take the interior normal nu to the domain, and you compare the value of the jth symbol on the normal and on the reverse normal, and they differ by a power of minus one. And it follows systematically. For j equals zero, you just have m here, and for j equals one, you have m minus one, and so on. And this should also hold for all derivatives with the corresponding power. If you take psi derivatives to the order alpha, then you should subtract the length of alpha up here. So that is the transmission condition. It was called for many years. I call it now the zero transmission condition. And for such operators, one can impose the usual boundary conditions and also some unusual ones. One can define trace operators, including the usual trace operators and something more that has a pseudo-differential nature. And we can also define operators going from the boundary and back. And they, in most of the studies that I work in, they're called Poisson operators, but they can also be called potential operators or co-boundary operators. And then one can set up a full calculus which contains the elliptic partial differential equations and their solution operators. And this calculus is named after Petit de Montbel because he initiated it in 1971. Okay, but then what if P is of non-integer order? Okay, and the most prominent example is the fractional powers of the Laplacian. You take the Laplacian to a power A between 0 and 1, and then you get an operator with a symbol which is the length psi to the power 2a, and you smooth it out at zero, and you have a little error that you can do good things with it. That's not a problem. This is a hot topic nowadays, and why? Well, it's most of all because of interesting applications in probability and finance. I mean, the short explanation is that the Black-Scholes equation that you can use when you want to predict the development of financial products, futures and options, is not good enough. It's better if you replace the Laplacian in it. I mean, it's the heat equation. You replace the usual Laplacian by such a power, then you get something that's better for the predictions you want to make. Okay, such an operator does not satisfy the zero transmission condition, and the Boutet-Montbel calculus does not work. First of all, because it's usually non-integer order, but even if it's of integer order, if you take a equals to a half, you have the absolute psi, you have the square root of the Laplacian, then it does not satisfy this transmission condition. And in the work that has been done on it, the applications people, they have not at all used pseudo-differential theory, but some of them use a kind of, well, they view it as a kind of singular integral operator, and they apply real methods from potential theory and integral operator theory, operators with real kernels. They don't, somehow, for some reason, they don't work complex at all. Or there are also methods from probability theory, because this is the generator of a Levy process. So, and they have methods too that can handle these operators. And I got interested in it in 2013. And I must say, what I'm not writing here is that I had to give a memorial talk about Lasomanda, and I look into all my old files and I found something that I thought was interesting, namely an old lecture note. But the other reason I got interested was that someone pointed out to me an interesting, a very much talked about regularity result that was stated to be completely new. And it was about this operator and its homogeneous Dirichlet problem. And that I found that puzzling because I thought that lots was new. What lots was known about the problem? So I found these old lecture notes, and It's written by Hermander in 1966 at the Institute for Advanced Study, and he gave it to me in 1980. And the result, the regularity result that puzzled me was for the what is called the homogeneous Dirichlet problem. Here now, let's just take a strongly elliptic operator, pseudo-differential operator P, that means that the symbol has positive real part. And here, this is a very good example. So we take an operator of order 2a, and we pose, it's of course non-local, but so there's a problem on how you assign it to the domain omega. But you take functions that are supported in the closure of omega, then you can apply it. And then you apply it and restrict back, R plus means restriction, back to omega, and you have want that to hit the function f. And if f is given in L2 and u is looked after in HA, the subgroup space of order A, then you can apply variational theory. You have a Lax-Milgram lemma, and you can show that this equation is Fredholm solvable when omega is bounded. And it's even uniquely solvable when P is sufficiently positive. So existence and uniqueness is not a big problem here. But the problem you are interested in is regularity. So I'll get to the next line. Does a better regularity of the right-hand side give a better regularity of U? That's of course a very natural question. And now this for the fractional Laplacian, there were two young Spaniards who had found the following result, and it was printed in 2014, but was already out then when I started to work in this area. And it was that when F is bounded, better than L2 bounded, then U has a structure D to the A times the Hilbert continuous function. And D is the distance to the boundary that you extend to a nice positive function on all of omega. And so they had this result. And they said, and it was claimed that it had not been shown before. And I must say, I don't think so either. But if any of you know a place where this is shown, I would add it to my knowledge. But I agree that it was new. And on the other hand, the note of Hermander had a big theory that led to the following result when omega is smooth, namely that when f is the infinity, then u is distance to the power a times a c infinity function up to the boundary. And vice versa, if u lies here, it is mapped into such functions when you apply p to it and restrict. And this was unknown to the two Spaniards. I got in touch with them, and because when I wrote my first paper on that, they addressed me and we got in touch. And they said they couldn't prove this. They could prove things for low smoothness, and they also can allow a low smoothness of the domain, but they couldn't get up to C infinity. They couldn't get up to this. Okay, so more about the story. Well, the intention of Hermander with these notes was to explain some ideas of Vishik and Eshkin that had just been posted in the Dukladi in the beginning of the middle of the 60s, and then supply this with his own analysis. So I need a little bit of notation now. Let me just focus on Bessel potential type Sobolev spaces that includes the L2 Sobolev spaces and gets close to many other interesting spaces. So the usual notation is on our N. It's the functions such that when you take the Fourier transform and multiply it by Xi to the power S, Xi is the usual smoothed out version of the absolute value. Xi to the S times U hat, and you take the inverse Fourier transform of that, it should be an LP. But then you have two scales of spaces associated with it when you have a domain omega. And one is the space of restrictions. So we take the restrictions to omega of the elements of HSP. This is a restricted space. And it's usually written not with this line over it, but I like the line, that I'll explain why. Then there is the supported space. That's the functions in HP that are supported in the closure of omega, and that's called the supported space, and I give that a dot. And that's usually given a zero or a dot or a tilde. Anyway, and so this, I think you can easily absorb as the functions that are supported in omega and lie in the big space. And the one with the line is just to tell the difference between the two if you write a formula short. In short form, you just want the dot and the line to tell the difference. And this notation comes from Hermander's notes, from Hermander's paper. Okay, so P, I just take it between 1 and infinity and omit it when P is 2. Yeah, and then what did Visik and Eshkin do? Well, of course, I can't try to begin to tell you all they did. They did lots of things. But looking into Eshkin's book that was translated to English in 81, they did certainly the following. They introduced the factorization index mu, which is a complex number, for which the principal symbol satisfies an equation like this. It's much like the zero transmission condition I had. It's only it has other numbers up here in the exponent. So you look at the value of the symbol on the normal at a point on the boundary, and then you compare the value on minus the normal, and you say that it is a twisted version of this normal, and the twisting is expressed by this exponential function. And anytime you take a homogeneous symbol, you can find a mu such that this holds. And if the symbol is strongly elliptic, you can find a mu that is not too far from A. I mean, my order was 2A, but A minus real part of mu is less than a half. It gives a unique definition of this mu, and that's what's called the factorization index. And there's also a unique definition more generally, but I'll just stay with strongly elliptic operators. And note that mu is allowed to be complex. That means that the length of this coefficient can be different from one. But if mu is real, then this is of length one. And if mu is zero, you have the zero transmission condition. Okay, and what did they show then? Well, now we look at the homogeneous Dirichlet problem that I had a moment ago, and we ask what happens when F is assumed to be in a restricted space HS over minus 2A. Then you would hope for U to be in HS in some sense. And that's true. It's true that U is in the dotted space with index S, when S minus the real part of U, mu, lies in this little interval around zero. That's one of their good results, which certainly extends the result you could get from just the variational theory. But what about other S? What about higher S? Well, for higher S, they had the following construction. Let's take the same S as here and introduce S prime as S plus some positive integer. And then the solutions of the homogeneous Dirichlet problem with S in this higher space, minus 2A, you would like them to be in HS prime. But they could be found in the following form. There's a term U plus that is in the dotted HS prime space. And then there's some more terms where they're constructed from F by constructing functions V on the boundary, V1 up to VK, from F by generalized trace operators, and then they applied some potential operators to them, going back to omega. And then you have various informations about these. This is at least one of the important results in the beginning of Eschins book, or in the first half of Eschins book. And what Hamanda did was something different. Well, first of all, he worked with very smooth objects, so he introduced the sharpening of this equation that he called the mu transmission condition. And it is really much the same as this equation, but extended to all the homogeneous terms in the symbol and extended to all the derivatives. So you have the 2a minus 2 mu, and then you should subtract j if you look at the j symbol, and you subtract the length of alpha if you differentiate with respect to xi alpha times. And differentiation with respect to x does not change any constants there. And you again, you ask that the value on the negative of the normal matches the value on the positive normal with this twisting at the boundary. So that's one new thing, or one different thing in his book, in his notes. And what did he do then? Well, he defined a very strange space. I find it strange, at least. It's a universal space. And I'll tell what it is for each S going up from this lower value. For a certain S, H mu of S is defined as those functions in the first domain I talked about at all, for which PU composed with restriction hits the space H bar S minus 2A. And this should hold for all P satisfying the mu transmission condition. And this space is topologized by the seminorms you get by giving you the norm of R plus PU. And then he determined that space. And I think that that kind of definition was common at that period. I mean, you had the point of view for elliptic operators that they had a regularity property that should hold for all of them. And so he wanted to find what is the regularity of all solutions when P runs through all possible operators satisfying this. And that takes many pages in the notes. It's a major part of the notes that finds out what this space is. And actually, I mean, the space could in principle be rather small because you take all P. It's the intersection of what you get from each P. But he showed the following theorem for each S, that this space HS mu is the solution space of the Dirichlet problem for each P. Each P that satisfies the mu transmission condition and is of order 2a has this as the solution space. And it can be pinned out what it is. It consists of functions that in local coordinates, when you get to the half space situation, there are functions that come that are generated in this way. You take functions in HS minus real part of mu with a bar, that's the restricted space. You extend by zero, E plus means you extend by zero. And then you apply this order reducing operator, a plus type order reducing operator that lifts the order by real mu again. And you get to something that on the interior it is HS, but at the boundary something else happens. And we call this the mu transmission space. Okay, those notes are sketchy and unfinished and obscure in some places. I mean, there's some places where you can't really see what the thoughts behind may have been. And he was working on other exciting questions at the time, and he stopped this work. And he gave the notes only to very few people. I suppose there was an audience at the institute that got them, and then of my colleagues, I know that Bouteille Mauvel got them in the 60s, and Sjöstrand and Melin received them, and I got them in 80. And we have put them on the Lund Library homepage if you want to see what's in them. And what I did now in 2013 was that I decided to do an effort to make that theory known, because it had something that doesn't seem to have been covered elsewhere. And by developing it further, figuring out how you prove the theorem here, and extending it to LP Sobolev spaces and other spaces, Hölder spaces, and more. And it turned out that I could find more satisfactory proofs on the basis of my own work on the Bouteille Mauvel calculus, in particular an LP paper I wrote in 1990. So the thing is here that the first impression is that this is way outside of reach of the Bouteille Mauvel calculus. That's true. It doesn't apply. On the other hand, there are some very important tricks in it that allow you to reduce the questions to a situation where you can use Bouteille Mauvel's calculus. And here I could use my own results to get nice proofs. Okay, so now I get to the recent results, and I'll explain what goes into it. Sorry, I have to have some water. Well, this operator that I had on the previous slide, call it chi plus with a T, the T is here. That's a well-known order reducing operator of plus type. It preserves support in Rn plus. And it defines a homeomorphism of Hn to H of Hs Rn to Hs minus real part of T Rn. And it also defines a homeomorphism from the dotted Hs over the half space to the dotted Hs minus real T over the half space, because it preserves support in Rn plus. And the difficulty in these old notes was that although you want to use this, it's not a true pseudo-differential operator. And what's not so good about it? Well, the thing is, here's a symbol. If you take derivatives in psi prime variables, they don't fall off so well as they should. Derivatives in psi n are fine. They get more and more decreasing to infinity. But derivatives in psi prime, they don't decrease better than the general order, or just a few steps down. And that means that there's not a pseudo-differential calculus that works perfectly with all the rules. I mean, the pseudo-differential calculus is somewhat complicated and difficult, but once you have set it up, it rolls. You can use it and you can get all kinds of things out of it, but this one doesn't really fit quite so well. And what I had done in my paper was to find a very good variant that is a true pseudo-differential operator and does the same job as chi plus. And I call it lambda plus. And there's even a version of it that works on the bounded set omega and does, as it, I mean, has these properties for omega. And that gives much easier proofs and shorter proofs and clearer proofs. And also one other benefit was that it allowed that the whole theory could be extended to large scales of function spaces, trivially Zorkin spaces and Biesow spaces, because the Bouteille Mauvel calculus can be extended to such spaces. And in particular, a particular case of the Biesow spaces is the Hölder-Zygmund spaces, because they are the case P equals Q equals infinity, and I just call them CS star. And they were also introduced by Stein. I mean, Eli Stein worked much with these spaces also and has a slightly different notation. They coincide with Hölder spaces when S is a non-integer positive number, and otherwise they have fill out very well with good interpolation theory and good duality theory, and then good negative spaces. I mean, S can be negative also. I'm sorry, I didn't mean duality. I mean, I meant that you could get negative spaces as well. Okay, and now then the result I can state that was proved in a paper in 15 and supplied with these other spaces in a paper that has 14 as its publication year, but came after. And I will just mention the two important cases, that the solution spaces, I mean these transmission spaces in the HP scale, is that you take HSP with S minus real part of mu up here, you extend it by zero, and you lift it by this order reducing operator, you lift it up to order S again. And that works when S lies in this range. So it works all up to infinity, actually. And also for the Hilbert-Siegmund scale, you have a nice result like this, that the transmission space is the lifting by the plus order reducing operator of extension by zero of the functions that are CS minus real part mu up to the boundary. You can drop the star when you have a Hilbert space, when you have an exponent that's not a, that is positive but not integer. So there are these nice results. And one interesting thing is that you have much more knowledge about what's in the spaces. In the HP case, the H mu S space coincides with the usual supported space when S minus real part of mu is in this small interval. The same thing as the Vichy-Geschkin theorem I quoted for P equals 2, which has been extended to general P by Eugene Shakarovsky and Shikadua and Dudukava have also worked on these things. And the higher space, as soon as you get past the 1 over p, the distance to the boundary pops up. Here you have a component in HSP. This is always a subset of this space. But you also have a component that has the distance to the power mu times an extension by zero of a restricted space. And when we go to the Hilbert-Siegmund classes where we have the same phenomenon, we get the Hilbert-Siegmund space if S minus real mu is less than zero. That's sort of not in focus. But if for higher S, we have this. We have a part in the dotted space, and we have distance to the power mu times extension by zero of a usual space. And this one is actually contained in that space, so the whole thing is contained in distance to the power mu times extension by zero of the usual restricted space functions that are Hölder S minus real part of mu up to the boundary. And here there's some technical exceptions for some special values of S. For example, when the Hölder space is not the same as the Hilbert-Siegmund space and things like that, that I'll overlook. So you note that the distance power pops up here, comes in. And why does it come in? Well, it comes in because you use this lifting operator that would lift functions in the dotted space very nicely, but doesn't lift as nicely on this space, because you have, when S minus real mu is high, you have a jump at the boundary. And this one has a jump at the boundary they have exactly this jump when you are in the second line here. And because and due to the formulas you get by working on this with pseudo-differential or with Fourier transformation and so on, you can see that this jump gives exactly rise to the distance to the power mu. And now I will say what this shows for the fractional Laplacian. Then I specialize the orders and values a little. The symbol here is even. I mean, it's symmetric in xi and minus xi. And therefore, it satisfies the A transmission condition at any boundary. So we are now, when we deal with that, we have the A transmission condition. Okay, there are also other operators that satisfy that, namely, take a strongly elliptic pseudo-differential order of order 2a with even symbol. That means that the jth term is reflected with a factor minus 1 to the j, holds for all j. Then it satisfies the A transmission condition at the boundary. And examples are, you take an elliptic differential operator of order 2 and you take its powers that you can construct from the resolvent. And so for all these operators, we get nice results for the resolvent, sure, for the solutions. Namely, when P is of this type, and then there's some restrictions on T, then when right-hand side is given in HT, with a P, then U is in the transmission space with T plus 2A, and the mu equals A in front. And similarly, in the Hilbert-Siegmund classes, you get that when F is in Hilbert-Siegmund T up to the boundary, then U is in this space. And as I already noted, this space can be written here, at least when the exponents don't hit special values, then it's simply d to the a times c t plus a over the close over the up to the boundary. And how does that compare to Rosatong and Serra, the result that had puzzled me when I worked on these things? Then with the advantage of our results here is that they work for arbitrarily high t and they allow x dependent symbols. But the methods, at least up until recently, what I'm saying is that we get a high t and we allow x dependent symbols, but also Tong and Sarah work only worked for t up to a and for translation invariant operators. I didn't say that before, but in the techniques they're using, they are working on integral operators defined from translation invariant kernels. And on the other hand, they have the advantage that they could allow low regularity of omega of the boundary here. And I'll get back to that point at the end also. But so far, I'm just working under complete smoothness of omega. Okay, I'll just tell some other things. It's not just the regularity that has been worked out. One further thing we can do is we can ask about non-homogeneous boundary problems. So again, we take P of order 2a and even and strongly elliptic. And then let's just look at the Hölder spaces where it's perhaps most clear what's going on. So we take it in the transmission space and with S greater than A, for some technical reasons, then you can define the weighted trace. You I mean, you have the solutions lying in d to the a times the Hilbert space. So you can divide by d to the a, and you can take the boundary value of that. And let's introduce that as a weighted trace in this special situation. And then there is a normalizing constant. And it's not so important, but it makes, well, one has to carry this along one way, in one way or another. So I chose to include it here in the definition. So here is a modified trace, which is this trace of u divided by d to the a with a normalizing constant. Gamma naught means the restrictions of the boundary. That is well defined when s is greater than a. And it has a role similar to the Neumann trace for the homogeneous Dirichlet problem. In fact, when a goes to 1, this will go to the Neumann trace. And that's also something that also Tom and Sarah noticed. I mean, they call it the Neumann trace. So now you can ask, is there a Dirichlet trace that allows you to define a non-homogeneous Dirichlet problem? Yes, there is if we go out in a larger space. We take the transmission space, not for the value a, but for the value in a minus 1. And then on that space, I mean, taking the value a minus 1, that one can easily show, I mean, by looking at the things, one can show that this is a larger space than that one. In the same way as for ordinary superlative space, there's no comparison there. You have to trust me, I haven't prepared to give the details of that. On the larger space, we can define this weighted boundary value where we divide by d to the a minus 1. Okay, yeah, maybe I can say something sensible about it. Anyway, I mean, here all functions have a factor d to the a, and now you add nice functions which have a factor d to the a minus 1, and then you can define these boundary values. And again, they're normalized by a suitable constant. And this will play the role of a Dirichlet trace. So what does it mean that you go into this space? Yeah, maybe I should get back to the presentation of, get back to this. If you replace mu by mu minus 1, you are in a space that has the same C as dot component, but it has a mu minus 1 here. It has a nice Hilbert space extended by 0, and then it has a factor mu minus 1 here. And the previous space, the space that just has mu, is contained in the larger space you get by putting in mu minus 1, at least when S is large enough. Okay, so let me get to that definition again. In these larger spaces, you can define this trace, and that will have the role of the Dirichlet trace. So what does it really mean? It means that you are now allowing functions that behave like d to the a minus 1 v for Hilbert continuous functions v. Think of v as smooth. Then you have put smooth on the interior. No, let's just say V is a Hilbert continuous function, and you look at what you get by multiplying by d to the a minus 1. Then since a was less than 1, this is a negative power, and these functions, they blow up like d to the a minus 1 at the boundary. And then the non-homogeneous Dirichlet problem is, again, you pose PU should be equal F on omega. You pose this special boundary value to be equal to some phi, and you again ask the support to be contained in omega bar. And it's not just, it was not my invention or Hermander's invention. Abatangelo, another young researcher, had it also in a paper at the same time, completely independently of my paper, that it would make good sense to study these problems. And indeed it does. They have Fredholm solvability when omega is bounded. And here, those solutions for which this boundary value is, or this trace is zero, they are the solutions of the homogeneous Dirichlet problem. You get back to that if you put a zero here. And one more thing you can do is you can ask about Neumann problems then. Why not? Okay, and it's possible again on that A minus one transmission space, and now the Neumann value is the Neumann, the usual Neumann value of U divided by D to the A minus one. And here's the Neumann problem, and it also has good solvability properties. Okay, so that's about, that was about non-homogeneous boundary value problems. And if there's time, I'm going too slowly, I suppose. Well, no, I have.
You have about 10 minutes still.
But you said one hour and a half.
Yes, one, but we started 5 minutes later.
Yeah, but then I have 15 minutes, don't I? Well.
Yeah, approximately.
Yeah, okay. I will perhaps go quicker anyway. So another thing is integration by parts formulas. You can do this type of formula, which involves the Neumann values on the boundary, and an extra term when you have x dependence. Also, Tong and Sarah showed this for operators that are not x dependent, and they showed it without the last term. And I can show it by totally different methods from them. And the interest of this formula is that it implies a Pohoshai formula that you can use in uniqueness proofs in nonlinear problems. And they certainly use that in some other very well estimated papers. You can also, if you go out to the non-homogeneous Dirichlet and Neumann values, you can show a Green's formula. If you go out to the transmission space with A minus one, you have something that looks much like the usual Green's formula, where you use these special Neumann values and Dirichlet values. These two terms are the usual ones, and then there's an extra term with a pseudo-differential operator in the boundary. And there's a third thing I wanted to mention that one can do, namely evolution problems, heat equations, where you can put P here equal to the fraction of the Laplacian and the other operators I've been talking about. And also here, you can get good solvability properties. So let me mention one of my results is if you take P symmetric, strongly elliptic, and homogeneous x-independent symbols. So we really restrict down to a rather nice case, and you take p between 1 and infinity, then this problem has, for any given f in LP and initial value 0, a unique solution that is continuous with values in LP, and it is in this space. It's LP of T valued in the transmission space, and H1 of T valued in LP. And moreover, any U of this form is mapped into the left-hand side here. So this is a sharp theorem that tells you exactly existence and uniqueness. And in this area, also Tong and other co-authors, Fernandez, Real, and Vivas, have fine results in Hölder spaces. excuse me, and they ask less smoothness of omega, but then they are not quite they're not sharp in the same sense as I have this. Okay, so those were some things that one can also show. And now I will get to the question of smoothness of the operators and domains. So because it is a criticism I've met that the applications people, they don't want to work on pseudo-differential operators. And the excuse they have is that we require too much smoothness. We require both smoothness in X variable and of the domain. But actually, much non-smooth theory does exist. First of all, the non-smooth symbols exist. Taking, for example, the X dependence to be only in a Hilbert space, C tau, of some order, that was initiated already in 78 by Kumanoko and Nagase, and there's some important contributions by Marshall and others, and they defined symbol classes C tau with respect to X, symbols of order M. And for boundary value problems, this concept has been extended to the Butenandt-Mauvel calculus by Helmut Abels. That's for integer order operators, and he extended the whole theory to C tau dependent symbols and used it to information on Navier-Stokes problems together with some co-authors. Now, this was one step in the non-smooth direction. Another step would be to make the domain less smooth, and that's a little bit more problematic. Then it's so that some results can be obtained by approximation from smooth domains, and also by some, on the principle level, a comparison of non-smooth and smooth. And if you are in a low regularity situation, that can be sufficient. But if you want high regularity, it's not. And if one wants that, one would like to localize, make coordinate changes to carry the operator defined in the neighborhood of a curved boundary over to an operator on the half space and to carry the full symbol along. And actually, that had not been done until very recently. Only smooth coordinate changes had been included in the non-smooth pseudo-differential theory. And non-smooth coordinate changes had not been done fully. I mean, something had been done on the principle level, but not on the full level. So I persuaded Helmut Abels to work on this with me, because he had these things and I know him very well. And we took us several years and we worked it out and finished last year in a joint work. And now I will have one technical slide with technical formulas. So you recall from the smooth case that when you have a diffeomorphism, I call it F, then you define the pullback. I think it's called the pullback. So I better let the formula speak for itself. This is denoted F star, and the other transformation is denoted F star with a minus one. And then an operator, even on Rn, gives an operator by a change of coordinates that I call P underline. So P underline U of X, that's P applied to U pulled over to the variable Y, and then evaluated at Y. So it's, you have both things in operation. P underline U is F star P, F star minus one of U. And the point is, what is P underline? And to explain that, I need to define two things. One thing is I take F, F is n-dimensional, and I take the gradient that gives a matrix, and then I do an integration here, and I get a matrix big A. I assume that if F is close to the identity, or yeah, or the gradient is close to the identity matrix, namely less than a half close, then this is defined everywhere. Otherwise, one has to take x, y near zero. Then we can define a simple or simple-like thing, q, x, y, xi, from this horrible formula. You take p, the original p, evaluate it at y, at fx. And you take, and the value xi is transformed by this matrix that's the inverse of that one transposed. And moreover, you multiply by this function, this is a nice function of x and y, and you multiply by this function also. Yeah, this is a function of y only. And then you get the expression q, and when you have that, then you have the formula for p bar, or p underline. So p underline is the operator with this symbol, q, x, y, xi, in the sense that you plug in the symbol in the formula where you have inserted the Fourier transform of u, and you integrate as usual, and out comes this operator. And this is still in a smooth case that this is okay. And this is an operator in xy form. I mean, it's not reduced back down to a symbol that's just a function of x and xi, but one can get down to the x form, an operator with a symbol p underline of x and xi, by this formula. It's a the type of formula that you meet often in the pseudo-differential theory. You take the q symbol and you reduce it to something that only depends on x by some hidden Taylor expansions that you insert in the integral and move around, and then you have a remainder. And all this works nicely for smooth symbols. And also, if the transformation, the change of coordinates is infinity, then it works for C tau symbols, if you just take terms up to tau, a number of terms up to tau, and that gives you symbols in C tau minus J classes. And what if F is non-smooth, if it's only C tau plus one that turns out to be the realistic space to aim for, then the difficulty in this program up here was most of all to give a sense to this expression. How can you reduce the x, y, xi form to x form? I mean, to give a sense to it. It is non-smooth in y now. It's not only non-smooth in x, but it's non-smooth in y also. And it turns out that you really need to do a lot of work to justify this formula. You need, of course, oscillatory integrals, as one does in the theory, but you also need to pin them out in small pieces that can be verified in different ways. And then once you have this, you also have to show a formula like this. And here you must content yourself with just having something that gives a bounded operator here. But it worked, finally. And then we did that last year, and we also looked at operators with the A transmission condition. And the A transmission condition is not so hard to generalize to symbols that are just C tau smooth. But it was important. Yeah, you need to, of course, also the domain in the picture. The transmission condition is something about what happens at the boundary, and that can be done. And it is in particular satisfied by the fractional Laplacian and by other pseudo-differential operators that are of order 2a and even. And then we could show the basic regularity result for these for these operators. You take tau greater or equal to 1, and at the same time it should be greater than 2a. and you take an operator that is even with symbol in C tau S2A, and you take a bounded C1 plus tau domain. And then when U is in the bottom class and solves the homogeneous Dirichlet problem for P, you have a smoothness property, namely for S up to tau minus 2A, when F is in HP, then U is in the space you would hope for, namely HS plus 2A dot and distance to the power A times HS plus A up to the boundary with a P. Okay, and actually this is just sort of a popular version. There is a transmission space, which is exactly where U lies. So there's a two-way thing. U in this space gives F here, F here gives U in that space. So finally, we got the non-smooth domains nailed down, at least for the basic result. And I would just point out why it's interesting. The important aspect is that it fills out the gap between low-order results under low-smoothness assumptions. That was also Torrens area and other guys. And high-order results that demand full smoothness of the operators and domains. Because now we can also have intermediate smoothness. P is just C tau, omega is just C tau plus 1. And then we get results with a regularity that is allowed to grow when tau grows. So it really fills out a big gap that was missing. There's also now a result by also Tom and someone else, and Abatangelo, who get Hölder results in the intermediate setting. And I'll stop here. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Grob.
What do I do now? I go this
nice presentation in a very traditional field. And questions, please. I have one question, peculiar for myself, actually. I was thinking now, sitting and thinking, is the special potential operators actually the fractional powers of elliptic operators?
Yes, they do. I mean, fractional powers of elliptic differential operators are allowed in this theory. Yes.
Yeah. And they map well. There are by the construction of Hermander, there is also such Bessel potential operators for bounded domains. What was for us interesting, even in the 80s, me, Frank Speck, and Reinhold Schneider constructed such Bessel potential operators for Lipschitz areas also, Lipschitz domains. And what was interesting in that work, that we constructed such Bessel potentials for cones, and then it turned out that if we can fit cone inside the Lipschitz domain, then it becomes the Lipschitz Bessel potential for this Lipschitz domain. And that was the idea. Maybe such things can work here in this.
Okay, I think I probably misunderstood. I mean, what specifically Bessel potential operators are, I'm not quite sure. Do you mean fractional powers of elliptic operators?
Bessel potentials, I mean, fractional powers of 1 plus psi square, and, well, it's almost fractional power of...
Do you mean something like order-reducing operators in non-smooth
space? Yes. Yeah. Not order-reducing, okay. But increasing also.
They are
fractional powers.
I shall look into it. If you tell me again the names of the people.
Yes, I will send you that with emails.
Yeah, do that. Yeah.
Yeah, perhaps it will have some connection with what we are doing also. For the Lipschitz domains, not for smooth, but for smooth boundaries, it was, of course, the classical Bessel potential operators. Yes.
Yeah.
Other questions and remarks?
Uh,
No? Then we thank
okay.
Professor Grube again. And, well, where is this? Either can switch your microphones and thank Professor Grube, or you can thank with emotions. I don't.
Thank you.
Yes, such emotions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.